Hi, everybody. Good to see you here. Today I'm going to talk about Pony ORM. But before I get to that, I would like to tell you why we are developing yet another mapper in the first place. In my previous life, I was a technical lead with a New York financial company, New York-based financial company. My co-founder, Alexander, has been interested in object databases since we were students. Databases became his passion, the area of research and teaching at the University of St. Petersburg. At some point, he came up with an idea of creating an advanced object-relational mapper, handy and efficient. He shared this idea with me, and I just loved the idea. After years developing products for such a dynamic field as finance, I saw the need for such a tool. If there was one, I would use it myself. This is how we started working on Pony ORM together. As you know, Pony is a sturdy, smart, and very friendly breed of horse. And so is our mapper. It is sturdy, smart, and user-friendly. So what makes Pony different from other mappers? First of all, it uses generators for writing database queries. This is an example of a generator. We get the product names with a price over 100. And this is the same query expressed in SQL. As you can see, the generator looks similar to the SQL query. Let's highlight the common parts. The select section is what goes to the resulting list. The from section is similar to the iterator section. And finally goes the condition. But this similarity is only in syntax. The behavior is completely different. A regular generator iterates over data stored in memory, while a SQL query selects data from the database. Imagine how cool it would be if we used generators for writing database queries. This is exactly what Pony does. Here's an example of querying Pony. The select function provided by Pony, it receives a generator as a parameter, but it doesn't execute it. Instead, Pony gets the generated bytecode. It translates it into SQL. Then Pony sends this query to the database and creates objects in memory based on the query result. This function returns a list of objects. The product is a class which is declared earlier in the code. It represents the product entity and is mapped to a corresponding database table. So let's compare the Pony syntax with other mappers. Here's the query in Pony. We select products with multiple conditions. The product name starts with A, the product has no image, or instead of the previous two conditions, the product was added before 2014. In Pony, we iterate over the product entity. See how can we use a standard Python function. For example, a name is a string, so we can use starts with function. And added is attribute of date time type, so we can use the attribute year. This is the same query in Django. The product class in Django has the objects attribute. It is a manager which is used for querying this object. In our example, we have both and or conditions. We can express and condition just providing a list, a comma-separated list. But in order to express or condition, we have to use the special Q object. And then we combine those conditions with the bitwise OR operator. In Django, we have to use double underscores in order to apply specific conditions such as starts with, is null, and less than. In SQL Alchemy, the same query will look this way. We get the session object and make the request to the product class. In Pony, we would use the P variable in order to apply the conditions. But in SQL Alchemy, we use the product class itself. In order to get the year from product edit attribute, we need to use the extract function. Also, we have to put parts of our condition into parentheses in order to keep the precedence of the bitwise operators. If we compare these queries, we look that they are pretty similar in the terms of length. Some people like Django and some people like SQL Alchemy syntax. But we like the generator syntax because it's easier to remember. It is the native Python syntax. You work with objects which are stored in the database, like they were stored in memory. It makes the development easier. Also, using generators is more performant than query translation, Django, or SQL Alchemy. That happens because in Pony, the result of the translation is cached. The select function receives a generator as a parameter, and the generator is a standard Python object, so we can use it as a key for getting the result of the translation of this query. In Django and SQL Alchemy, there is no such a key because the filter function just receives a set of parameters. And that is why we necessary to translate this query every time in Django and SQL Alchemy when we execute it. Pony makes the translation of the bytecode only once. With other mappers, you can build queries step by step. How is it possible using generators? Pony also allows building queries step by step, adding conditions one after another. This is done with the help of the filter function. It receives a lambda expression as a parameter. This function returns a new query object which, with the applied condition. In this example, we add a couple of conditions, then order the result and slicing it. And you can see the result of the last applied condition of the slicing. Now let's see how Pony translates generators into SQL queries. Some people may think that it's a complex process and it's too much magic in it. I want to show you how it works so you can see that it's pretty fast and straightforward. The translation process consists of three steps. In the first step, we get the generator and its code object. As you know, Pony Python doesn't provide an abstract syntax tree for generators, so we have to restore it from the bytecode. In the second step, Pony translates this AST into abstract SQL. It is an intermediate representation of SQL. It is almost SQL, but it's not a SQL query text yet, because databases, they have some peculiarities in terms of representation of SQL queries. And different dialects can vary. So that is why we don't want to overcomplicate the translation part. We just put it as another step. So the first step is decompilation of the bytecode and restoring abstract syntax tree. For decompilation, Pony uses an object which implements the visitor pattern. It has a set of methods, and each method name corresponds to a bytecode command. We go through the bytecode from top to bottom and call the corresponding method. While executing the bytecode, we accumulate it on a stack. Let's say we have such an expression, and now we are going to translate it to SQL. We get the bytecode from the generator object, and this is the stack where Pony will accumulate the AST parts. Now we process the first command, load global. We call the method of the visitor object with the same name, and this method pushes the name node to the stack. The next command, load fast. The name of this command is different from the previous one because it loads a variable from a different namespace. But for the translator, it does the same thing, it just loads a variable. Pony pushes the corresponding AST node to the stack. The next command is load other. This command we apply to the top of the stack. We wrap the existing node with the new one, get attribute. The binary add command pops two stack elements and then pushes the binary add command, which wraps those two existing nodes. It combines the previous two. Then we load the x attribute, the x variable, and get y attribute of x. And finally, we pop two stack elements and push the compare node, which combines them. As you can see, this process is very straightforward. It doesn't have that too much magic. And usually, generator code is not that long. Also, we don't need to build the whole decompiler here because generator just has a subset of Python bytecode operations. As a result of the first step, we get such an AST. It is a tree representation of the same expression. The second step is translation to abstract SQL. But which SQL should we build? Can we tell that just looking at this expression? It depends on variable types. For example, A and C can be strings or numbers. Y could be a string or a collection. If A and C are numbers, and Y is a collection, then we should generate a numeric addition and a subquery. If they are strings, then we should generate the string concatenation. If Y attribute is a collection, then we should use a subquery. If all of them are strings, then we need to use concat and like operators. If we will analyze all these variable types inside the translator, we'll have a lot of if-then statements inside the translator, and it will overcomplicate the translator itself. It will hard to maintain and extend such code, so we should somehow structure the logic of our translator in order to keep the translator simple. And for this purpose, we use monads. A monad is a container which encapsulates the translation logic. Each node type has its own translation logic. The translator walks through the tree and delegates the translation to different monads. Each monad accumulates data and generates a part of a SQL query as the result. Pony has different monads for different types, for different attributes. Each monad defines a set of permitted operations and also how it will be combined with other monads. And each monad generates a particular part of the resulting SQL query. Here I show you different monad types. We have a lot of them, but just some part of it. String monads know how to make operations with strings. For example, this string utter monad can generate a join operation, and string param monad puts a string parameter into a query. Using monads keeps the process of translation simple. We walk the syntax tree and we process each node when we exit from the node. We walk the tree all the way down using the depth first strategy. When we enter the addition node, we don't have all the necessary information for generating SQL yet, because we don't know types of nodes which lay lower. And we continue walking the tree all the way down. When we leave the node, we create a monad. Let's say that A is an external string parameter. Then we create a string param monad here. Then we walk further. Before leaving the node, we create another monad. In our example, B is an iterator variable. So we create the object iter monad. This monad knows on which object we are iterating in our query. Then we walk further. And then the translator processes this node. It doesn't analyze the node at all. It just delegates the get attribute operation to the previously processed monad. It says to the object iter monad, get the attribute C from yourself and create a new monad, which will be a result of this operation. And it creates a string utter monad because it knows the type. Then we walk further. And now the translator gets the left monad and says, add yourself to the right monad. By this time, we know all the types of operands, and this string, and we create a string expert monad. And this monad can generate the part of SQL for this green nodes of our tree. This way, all the processing logic is encapsulated inside the monads. It helps to keep the translator simple, and we can easily extend our translator by adding monads which can handle new types, for example. So we work further. And at the end, we have the top-level model that has the generated SQL for the whole tree. Here the abstract SQL that we get as the result of the translation. It is stored by like a list by now, and it reminds Lisp structure. So the first element of this list is a comment, and then goes appearance of this comment. For example, this like comment, the first parameter is the column y from the table t1. Then goes the function concat, which is followed by four arguments that should be concatenated. By this moment, the process of the translation is almost done. And the last step of the translation is to translate it to a specific SQL dialect. This is a very simple step. Pony has a set of database providers, and those modules keep the knowledge of the database peculiarities when it comes to SQL syntax. We walk our list structure using the visitor pattern again and combine the resulting SQL into a query string. Here you can see the result of the translation to MySQL and SQLite dialects. What other features? This is it with the translation. So this is the last step, and we got our SQL query, which can be cached and sent to the database. By this time, Mapper did what it is needed. And now I would like to tell you about other Pony features. Pony keeps the objects in the identity map. It means that each object is loaded only once within the same database session. When we try to get the same object again, no query goes to the database. It will be returned from the map. Pony also has the N+1 query problem solution. This is when a mapper generates a lot of unnecessary queries. I'll show you in a minute how it works with Pony. Pony can optimize queries. For example, it can substitute a subquery with a left join in order to improve performance. Also, Pony can work with the database using pessimistic and optimistic concurrency control. The pessimistic approach is when we log a row in a database in order to prevent it, its modification by another transaction. With optimistic approach, there is no log. Before committing, Pony just verifies that no other transaction changed the value of the attribute which it read. And Pony also has online entity relationship diagram editor. You can build a diagram of your application online and get the code for your entities or SQL scripts for creating tables. Let's look at this example. Say we use Django and we want to select a couple of students from the database. Also, we want to print out their names and the group IDs. How many queries will be sent to the database and how many objects will be created after we execute this code? Let's see. After the first query will be executed, a student object will be created in memory. When we access the group attribute, the second query will be sent to the database, and the second object will be created in memory. Now we create another student object. Let's say that both students belong to the same group. When we try to access the group attribute, Django will create another group object. It is a copy of the existing one. This happens because Django doesn't implement the identity map pattern. Each object exists independently, and Django doesn't track if a similar object was already created. Let's see how it is implemented in Pony. The Pony syntax is a little bit different. As you can see, we use square brackets in order to get access by a primary key. After we execute the first line, we have the following. A query went to the database, and an instance of a student was created. Now Pony sees that there is a group object which is associated with this instance. It means that this group ID exists in the group row in a group table exist in the database. Pony didn't load this object yet, but it knows that it exists for sure because it's a consistent database. And Pony creates a seed object. This is how we call the object which has only its primary key. The other attributes were not loaded to this object, it's just like a seed of an object. And using this concept of seeds allows us to make some optimizations. For example, we don't need if you don't need any other attributes but just group ID, Pony will not send any other request to the database because the primary key of this group is already known. If we would like to get any other attribute of group, then it will be the request will be sent to the database. But in our example, we don't need to send any requests because the ID presents in the student table itself. Then we load the second student, and Pony sees that this object has the same group ID, and it links it with the same seed. If we need to get an attribute of the group object for one of or both students, Pony will send just one query to the database. But there is a probability that we don't need to send any other requests. The concept of seeds allows us to solve n plus one query problem. Let's say we have an online store and we want to get customer orders which have the total price of the order greater than 1,000. In this example, we use the order by method. We sort the result in the descending order because we want to see the last customer orders first. Also, we are getting the first page of the result. The page method, it's just syntax sugar. We can use slice, but it's more easier to use the page because usually we want to show the results at the web page. And this is the SQL query which will be generated for the first line, first two lines. And when we start iterating over the order list, in this case, most mappers will run into the n plus one query problem. It is when a mapper will generate a separate SQL query in order to load each customer, in order to show its name. And n here, it's a number of items in the orders list. In Pony, it will work this way. The first query loads orders to the memory, and Pony creates seeds for all customers' objects. We can see what customers might need if we will iterate over the list. And when we iterate over this list, we get the first customer attribute. Pony loads all the seeds objects with one SQL query instead of n queries. This query selects all customers' objects with the ID belonging to the list. In terms of query cost, it's not a big difference if you load one row from a table or 10 rows. The performance degradation usually happens when we do a lot of database round trips. Of course, there is a probability that we don't need all the objects, but usually in a web application, we don't load thousands of objects. We just load some part of it in order to show it at a web page. And that is why if we load all the objects by one query, it increases the overall mapper performance. In Django, of course, we can use select-related or prefetch-related something, and other mappers also have some similar feature. But the thing is that a programmer needs to think about it himself. And sometimes newbie programmers, they put select-related everywhere where it is needed and not. And if you put it everywhere, it hurts performance. But if you don't put it where it is needed, it hurts performance too. Having this concept of seeds allows us to avoid n plus one query problem automatically. And you don't need to think about where you need to put it. Actually, it's a smart way to do prefetch related. Also, if you use select related, it generates queries using join in order to join all the necessary attributes from other tables. And if you do a lot of joins in a database, it can be less performant if you just select data from one table. So when we select those customer IDs and customer objects in a separate query, we can join those records in Python, and it can be more performant and more scalable. Another thing that we have in Pony is automatic query optimization. Here's an example. When we translate this generator to SQL, we get this query. And this query has a subquery, and it is called correlated subquery because it uses values from the outer query. The correlated queries should be evaluated for each row selected from the main query, and it can be inefficient. And there is a well-known technique of replacing correlated subqueries with left joins. Pony does this optimization automatically. Now let's talk about transactions. Let's say we need to write a function that transfers the specified amount from one account to another. If we use Django, we could start with something like this. Here we get the first account object by its primary key and check the available amount. If there is not enough funds, then we erase the exception. Otherwise, we get to the second account, decrease the first account, save the object, increase the second account, and save the object. Are there any problems with this function? The problem is that these two account operations are not performed in the single transaction. We have two separate transactions here. And if we lost the database connection after the first save completed, we can leave the database in the inconsistent state. We can, of course, solve this problem and add the decorator transaction atomic. Did it solve the problem? Not necessarily, because this function can still overwrite data if they were changed by a parallel transaction. When we do save, it doesn't take into account if this data were changed by another transaction. And we can have the database in the inconsistent state again. In order to avoid this, we can use a special F expression or lock the records in the database. And for this purpose, we can use the select for update method. This way we lock the records in the database and no other transaction can change them until our transaction is finished. The inconvenience is that a programmer needs to specify the select for update method explicitly. Often an application consists of several tiers, and in more complex applications we can get data in one tier, then pass it to another. And at that point, we can just miss this knowledge, and we might overlook the point where it should be locked in the database. And if we will use select for update everywhere in order to avoid this problem, it again will hurt performance. In Pony, you can use the select for update method too, but beside this, Pony uses the concept of optimistic locking. Here's how we can write our function Pony. The DB session decorator is mandatory when we access the database, and it wraps the database updates with a single transaction. We get the first account object and check the available amount. If there is enough funds, we decrease our account and increase the other one. And you can see that there is no need to call the save method, because Pony tracks the objects which were changed due to using identity map. And all that changes will be sent to the database automatically when we leave the scope of the DB session. What will happen if a parallel transaction changes the amount of any account? Pony tracks the attributes which were read and written during the transaction. And when we read the attribute amount of the account object, Pony remembers the old value of this attribute. And now, when we save the updated value to the database, Pony adds additional where condition where, with this check. The update query returns the number of rows which were updated during the operation. If the value was changed by a parallel transaction, then the update SQL operator will return zero. And that means that other transaction changed the value, and we have to roll back the current transaction in order to avoid the database inconsistency. This approach is called optimistic locking. We don't lock the object, but we keep the old value of each attribute which we read or wrote. When we commit this object to the database, we verify that this object holds the same state. This approach is more performant and scalable than locking the row in the database. It allows more parallel transactions to work simultaneously. Pony helps to avoid lost updates and keep database consistency automatically. Even if a programmer didn't take measures, when the DB session decorator will lose the scope, it will check if the database is in the same state. Another thing which we have in Pony is entity relationship editor. You can create ER diagrams for your applications online, and this editor has several tabs. The first tab is where you can design your diagram. We represent entities with rectangles, and also you have attributes, data attributes, and relationship attributes. In Pony, you specify relationship with both attributes at both sides. So here we follow the rule, explicit better than implicit, it is easier to see what attributes the entity has when you look at it. So here you can see that relationship, we use a line in order to depict the relationship, and if it is a relationship too many, it has a fork at the end. Also, you can switch the tab, get the second tab, Python code, and you will see the Python code of your entities. There are several other tabs where you can see SQL scripts for creating tables in the database. So those are main features which I told you today. We have generators and lambdas for database queries. Pony implements the identity map. It has a solution for N+1 query problem. It has an automatic optimization of correlated queries, optimistic transactions, entity relationship diagram editor. And here the roadmap of Pony ORM development. At the moment, we are working on adding Python 3 support because it's the most often asked feature. Then we add in Microsoft SQL Server support, because at this moment we support only four bases: SQLite, MySQL, Postgres, and Oracle. And we were asked about adding support for Microsoft SQL Server. And after this is done, we will add migrations and asynchronous queries support. This is it. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
Hello. Can you return to the slide with DB session decorator? Oh, it's okay.
With the DB session, this one?
Yeah. No. Yes, this one. How it is done? It is thread locals or something like that?
Thread local.
Okay.
I didn't quite understand that question. I hope I'm not asking the same question again. If this now fails because the second, so the update is not done because there was some other thing, will it automatically retry to do the thing or will it just fail?
You can specify as a parameter to this data DB session decorator, or it can be used also as a context manager. You can specify a retry, for example, 3 or 5, and it will retry.
Oh, okay.
In the N plus one query solution, how does Pony know for which items in the second query to load the values?
Well, when we execute a query,
so you do the first query to load the orders.
Yeah.
And then you have the second query for the customers.
Yeah, because order has a relationship to one. Each customer has a relationship to many. Let me show the diagram. So this is the diagram which I used for that example. See, when we go to orders.
Yeah, I understand that there's a relationship, but how do you know in which customers will be in the loop? Do you just?
We don't know which where we're going to loop over. We just create seeds for those objects which it has relationship to one. And when we start iterating over these objects, we understand that it might be needed all other objects.
So if there is one customer name, you load the name for all the customers.
Yeah, when we send this request to the database. Yeah. It's not a big difference. We load one row from this table or 10. Not a big difference in terms of performance.
So then you load for all the orders or customer seed objects that exist?
Yes. Then we have all the seeds, and then we load using this query. You see the last line where CID in the list of IDs.
And then you load for all the seeds that exist?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it seems to me that after you have realized the seeds, so they have become objects, there's a lot more caching happening. And I can imagine that can also be very dangerous to you, right? You're using weak references, or I mean, how do you know that after you have fetched now all these customers, that they can be and you somehow globally cache them so that other queries okay, so for order one, you select the customer one and you realize it, and then for order three, you have some global reference to it, so that you can fetch it again.
Yeah, I think I got your question. But you know, this identity map, this cache, exists within one transaction. So when we start our transaction, we use DB session, and when this DB session scope is over, we just free the cache. So. And usually, you don't work with millions of objects when you build an application, right? You don't use a million. You can use bulk update if you want to update or work with million objects. Usually, you load, say, 10, 20, 100, maybe 1,000 in order to show it a web page. And in this case, it's not the big amount of objects we have.
Hey, comparing MySQL and SQLite, for example, MySQL has strongly typed columns, and SQLite allows you to insert any data type that you want. How do you handle these heterogeneous data types, or do you just disallow them, or what do you do?
How do we hold what?
In SQLite, you could conceivably stick different data types into the same column. SQLite allows you to do that. How do you handle this in your mapping? Do you only allow insertion of specific data types, or whether you filter them out? What happens, really?
When we specify the type of object, sorry, I didn't quite hear what the...
Okay, let me restate that. In MySQL, your column specifies what data type will be contained within. In SQLite, the column type is just a suggestion. You can still have different data types, whether it's mm-hmm. integers or text or dates.
Okay.
How do you handle that?
Well, in Pony, we have different DB API, IPA providers. And in terms of Pony, all those types are exactly the same. And this DB provider takes into account some peculiarities of the database. But we use the Python notation of date time, and we represent it the same way in SQLite. Maybe you're talking about the difference in microseconds, for example, right, with this type in MySQL and SQLite. And Pony takes that into account using this a layer over the DB API driver on this particular DB API provider. We handle that.
Hi. Is it possible in Pony to iterate over results without having all the results in
Please
memory?
Just speak up.
I'm sorry. Is it possible in Pony to iterate over results without having all the results in memory?
To iterate over?
Like with a database cursor.
Mm-hmm. So you mean don't load all that objects to memory, but iterate just in the database?
Yes.
Well, it is. We need that if we want to update a lot of records at once, right? Bulk update. And for that purpose, we have one method. But recently we were asked about adding just a little bit more, and we are going to add more functionality to that, so you can update objects without loading them to the data cache.
So I guess we have time for a last question.
Okay.
Hi. You mentioned on one of your first slides that it was fast, this particular ORM. So what makes it fast, and how does it compare to others? Do you have benchmark data?
Mm-hmm. We ourselves didn't create a robust and good test yet. We definitely going to do that. But other users, they tried to compare that, and they say it's like 3-4 times faster. Why it is faster? First of all, it's because we can cache the result of the translation, as I told. Because in Django and SQL Alchemy, there is no way to understand that we execute the same query. With Pony, when our program is being executed, we can see that this is the same generator, and it has ID, right? So we can immediately understand that we don't need to translate it once again. We just can get the result from the cache. And also, when we develop Pony, we are very picky in terms of working with references, objects. We don't do deep copy a lot. We just pay attention to details when we just use a low footprint in terms of resources when we need to, when we work with objects with cache. We try to take into account the performance is the one of the goals which we have in our mind.
Thanks a lot for your talk.
Thank you.